All right, so there's one interaction that kept frustrating me as I built out these chatbots, and that was email validation. And instead of getting frustrated with the potential solutions on the market, I said, okay, let's sit down and let's actually solve this and figure out how to handle this, because this is really important, because capturing emails is one of the main functions that you want your chatbots to do. So let's talk about what the current options are. Option one is we do nothing, right? You say, what is your email address? And if I say, my email address is connor@rumble.ai, I'm capturing the entire reply in here, which, okay, that's kind of okay, but it's not really that helpful. And that's not very that useful. So that's not the greatest thing. Option two, VoiceFlow entities. Now, for those of you that are unaware of what a VoiceFlow entity is, come to our content tab. An entity is pretty much a smart variable. And we're telling VoiceFlow, okay, this variable store is going to be an email address. So pay attention here. So if we run this, and the way that you can do this in the capture step, instead of capturing the entire user reply like I did previously, you create a new entity. And this one's named is entity email. So if I do this again, my email is connor@rumble.ai. It responds connor@rumble.ai. Okay, so the value of this entity variable is my cleaned email, which you're like, okay, this is something. This is good. And entities do work if everything goes perfectly, if the chatbot user responds how you expect them to. But watch what happens if you don't. My email address is Connor at. Okay, now the variable store is the letters CON, which is not my email address. Connor at is not a valid email. And not only that, the result that's in that variable, it's not useful to me. I can't really do anything with it. And I don't know what's going to get stored in there. The user does not type in something that looks like an email address. Now, VoiceFlow is aware. It was a good attempt at them to try to set this up. And they have advertised that they might have some additional things in the work to improve this. And maybe their improvements will make these more functional. But they just don't work in enough use cases, in my opinion, for them to be regularly integrated into your builds. Okay, what's the third option? Set AI, which basically says, okay, the user just responded with some sort of phrase. I want you to look at this large language model and I want you to extract this. So here's kind of a prompt that you would see. User has just uttered a phrase that should contain an email address. Here's the phrase, which was potential email, which is exactly what we captured before. Output only the email address. And if there's no email address in the phrase, output the character zero. Only output that single character. Do not break this rule. And then we've got a few examples here. And what happens? My email address is connor@rumble.ai. GPT 3.5 did a pretty decent job here. One of the drawbacks to this is, one, I'm using tokens, so that doesn't make me feel that great. And number two, it suffers some of the same shortcomings as entities do. If I say my email address is Connor at again, it will do the same exact thing that the entity did, which is say, okay, your email address is Connor at. So there are, once again, fringe use cases or responses from the chatbot users that this is not a very good solution for. Okay, what else is out there? Can also use some JavaScript string manipulation. And there are a couple different functions that we could potentially use. One of my favorites is to use a regular expression here. And I know that this kind of looks crazy, a bunch of jumbled letters and numbers here. But basically, what we're doing is we're looking for a particular pattern. And we want to look for this B here, backslash B, is setting a boundary. Okay, here's the start of the pattern, which in the brackets are all the characters that could be before the at symbol, which is uppercase A through Z, lowercase A through Z, the numbers 0 through 9, and then some special characters. And then this plus at symbol, I'm looking for the exact character at, and then we have another bracket with checking the next part of the pattern, which is a bunch of potential letters and numbers. The at Gmail, at Umbral. And then we have another syntax to catch the period. And then on the back end here, you see A through Z uppercase, A through Z lowercase, and then this curly bracket 2. And that's to dictate the end of the email address should contain at least 2 characters, right? .co, .ai. Those are valid TLD endings for an email address. Okay, Connor at umbral.ai is valid, but Connor.umbral or at umbral.a is not valid. And basically what we do is we take our variable, which is potential email, and then do the match against the pattern. And then we overwrite this variable with either the match, which we have validated, or null, which is good because watch what happens now. My email address is Connor@umbral.ai. Great, we've extracted Connor@umbral.ai. Look what happens if I try. My email is Connor@. We have null, okay? So this failed the test, and if we do something else, like my email address is none of your business, it's null, okay? Now, why is this useful? So now I only have 2 potential outcomes of this JavaScript. One, I have an email that's been checked and looks to be potentially validated, or I have a null. So now what I can do is I can send that through an if statement. Come on, you can do it, buddy. And if it passes the obvious check, I can go on with the rest of my flow and do something here. But if it's invalid, I can also say, hey, that wasn't a valid email. Please try again. Then I can loop it back into the beginning and run it through again here. So now this flow looks like my email is Connor@. It fails because it's null. Hey, that wasn't a valid email. Please try again. And I say, oh, my bad. My email is actually Connor@umbral.ai. Boom, it passes. Now, the variable response, I put nothing in here, so it stopped, ended the test. But now, okay, I've got something that I can work with here that has some level of reliability that is an improvement over the other options. Now, this regular expression is not bulletproof, but it's something. So now you can say, okay, great, Connor, we solved email extraction. Awesome. This is great. Wrong. We're only halfway there. Now what happens if I say my email address is Connor is the greatest chatbot builder in the world at gmail.com. Okay, that passes the regex expression. Do you think Connor is the greatest chatbot builder in the world at gmail.com is an actual email address? The answer to that is no. And also, it's not a true statement, but that's besides the point of this video. So why is this a problem? Okay, I am asking for an email address as part of my chatbot flow because I'm going to do something with that email address. Okay, and if I've built out a chatbot for a client, that email is going to immediately get inserted into some sort of automation. And if this is not an actual email address, and I send a welcome email or some product information or something, what happens if I send an email automated to Connor is the greatest chatbot builder in the world at gmail.com? It's going to bounce. Now, why is this an issue? Well, just recently, Big Daddy Google, the end of last year, said, hey, email senders, we've got our eyes on you. And if your bounce rates start to go up above a certain threshold, we're going to stop your ability to send emails or we're going to close your accounts. So if you have these automations set up with clients that are getting a large amount of traffic and you have users on the other ends of the chatbot that aren't entering valid emails, you could very easily have your automations close their email accounts if you are not careful. So we need to take this a step further. And this is where I'm going to introduce a third-party service, which was called Zero Bounce, okay? And what Zero Bounce does is they take the email address and they go check the DNS server records for whatever the email platform is. And they make sure that this is an actual valid registered email address that exists. So if you run an email checker through the service, you can confidently send your automation emails out without worrying that they're going to bounce. And what's great is we can hit their APIs very quickly, get a response whether this is valid or not. One of my favorite things about this, we look at the pricing, we're like, oh, $18 a month, great, this is another thing I have to pay for. You have a pay-as-you-go method, and you get up to 100 emails free. So if you have a small business client that you're building this out for, there's a chance that this could be completely free for you to check this. And if it's not free, you're paying 1 cent per validation, which has to be one of the best deals possible in order to ensure that your client's emails are actually hitting where they need to go. It's an easy, easy buy. So how does this look as part of the build? Here we go. So what we're going to do is we're going to ask for an email address. We're going to run it through an obvious checker, which is, you know, what we did with the regular expression. Then we're going to have our Zero Bounce API key. And, oh, I didn't show. The Zero Bounce API here is going to return a status valid if this is a valid real email address. And if not, we'll obviously return invalid. So we're going to send a GET request to Zero Bounce. We're going to put the potential email here. Now, also remember, this has already gone through the JavaScript regular expression, okay? So we're not going to ping Zero Bounce and waste tokens on emails that we obviously know are not emails here. So if it passes the obvious check, we're going to hit Zero Bounce API. If it doesn't, we're going to say, hey, I'm sorry, that did not contain an email address. Could you please try again? Now, if it does, we're going to capture the response from the API request and store it into a variable, and then check it with an if statement. If it's valid, great. Now I'm going to set valid email. That way I know later on in my builds that this email has been validated and I want to use this in all of my automations. And if it doesn't, well, that appeared to look like an email address, it's actually not a registered one. Could you please try that again? So let's run this and watch what happens. My email address is Connor@. Okay, that's obviously not an email address. It fails regex. I'm sorry, your responses did not contain an email address. Could you please try again? Ooh, my bad. It's actually Connor@umbral.ai. Oops, I put a 9 in there. So I messed that up again, fat fingered it, which is easy to happen when you're interacting with these chatbots. And that's why it's important that flows like this exist. Oops, fat fingered that. It's Connor@umbral.ai. I hit Zero Bounce. I'm valid. Thank you for providing your email address of Connor@umbral.ai. Now watch if I try that again. Connor is the best chatbot builder in the world at gmail.com. While that appeared to look like an email address, Connor is the best chatbot builder in the world at gmail.com, is not an actual registered email. Could you please try again? And there you have it, okay? That way we're hitting all of these fringe cases. We're only passing emails to Zero Bounce when we know that they are potentially good emails. And now we want to double check to make sure that they're valid because I want to use them in my automations in the future. So if you combine this obvious checker with Zero Bounce's API, you can consistently get the emails that you want from your chatbots. Whew, it's a mouthful. But anyways, I'm extremely happy with how this is working. And I'm sure some of you might be like, hey, Connor, can we get these blocks? I want to start using this immediately in my chatbots. And here's the good news. The answer is yes. And this is an announcement. I'm releasing Email Validator as the first set of chatbot utility blocks that I will be releasing here. And Email Validator is free. So the only thing that I'm going to ask for is an email address. And that's because I've got some additional stuff that I'm working on that like this that I think that you guys might find useful. And I've also have a link to Zero Bounce down in the description as well. And yes, it's an affiliate link. It's 2024, so grow up. But this is something that I'm using immediately now in all of my builds because it's a penny per email validation. But anyways, let me know what you guys think. And if you have any particular ideas of things like this that you'd like to see me build out for you guys, send me an email. Thanks. Appreciate it. Talk to y'all later.